Hi everybody, this is CA Balakrishna. This video is in continuation to our Foreign Exchange Management Act. In this video we will be discussing ECB, that is External Commercial Borrowings. First of all, we will understand what exactly the term ECB means, that is External Commercial Borrowing means. See, understanding the term External Commercial Borrowings. ECBs are commercial loans raised by eligible resident entities from recognized non-resident entities and should conform to parameters such as, see, first of all, ECBs are basically commercial loans, that is, we can call them as business loans, which are raised by eligible resident entities. Entities in India which are eligible to raise ECBs. We will discuss what are eligible entities. If an eligible entity in India raises commercial loan from recognized non-resident entities, from recognized non-resident entities outside India and conforming to some parameters, then such a loan will be known as External Commercial Borrowings. See, in this definition, if we understand who are eligible resident entities and who are recognized non-resident entities and what will be the minimum maturity and what are permitted and non-permitted end uses and maximum all-in cost, then our concept of ECB will be completed. So, if we understand those highlighted parts, the concept of ECB will be completed. We will discuss each of those highlighted parts in the coming slides. Let us understand this concept of external commercial borrowings with the help of a diagram. Let's say in India, we are having eligible resident entities. And in US, we are having recognized non-resident entities. When this eligible resident entities in India raises commercial loan from recognized non-resident entities in USA, then such type of borrowings will be known as external commercial borrowings. This is briefly the understanding of ECBs. Now let us move into types of ECBs. Basically, ECBs can be categorized based on two criteria. The first criteria will be based on approval, and the second criteria will be based on currency in which the ECB have been raised. Types of ECBs can be categorized based on two criteria. The first criteria will be based on approval required for ECB, and the second criteria will be based on currency in which ECBs have been raised. Starting with based on approval, under this there are two types of ECBs. First type will be through approval route, and the second type will be through automatic route. See, we can also interpret this in this way. ECBs can be raised through approval route or through automatic route. Okay, what types of ECBs can be raised through approval route and what types of ECBs can be raised through automatic route? Let's see this. Under approval route, borrowers have to send the request to RBI through their authorized dealer category 1 banks for approval. Basically, under approval route, borrowers need to obtain approval of RBI. Okay. Under automatic route, the cases are examined by authorized dealer category 1 bank and the limit will be US$750 million per year. That means if a eligible borrower has to borrow amount up to US$750 million per year, then he can go through automatic route. If the amount exceeds this $750 million per year, then he has to obtain ECBs through approval route. Under automatic route, the approval of RBI will not be required. The ECB will be examined by authorized category banker one himself. And now moving to second category, that is based on currency in which ECB is raised. Basically, ECBs can be raised in two types of currencies. First one will be foreign currency denominated ECBs, and the second one will be INR denominated ECBs, that is Indian rupee denominated ECBs. These will be the two types of ECBs that can be raised. And note, ECB can be in the form of bank loan, debentures, bonds, trade credit beyond 3 years, FCCBs and FCEBs, financials. See, an entity in India can raise ECB either as a bank loan from outside of India, or entity in India can issue debentures to people outside India for the purpose of raising ECB, or can issue bonds or through trade credit beyond 3 years. Next one will be through issuing FCCBs and FCEBs. Now let us understand what these FCCB and FCEB means. Basically, FCCBs means foreign currency convertible bonds. That means these bonds can be converted into equity shares of the entity which is issuing these bonds. Those types of bonds will be known as FCCBs. Whereas FCEBs, that is foreign currency exchangeable bonds. That means these bonds cannot be converted into equity shares of the entity which is issuing them, but these bonds can be exchanged with the equity shares of another entity apart from the entity which is issuing these bonds. Okay, hope this concept is clear. FCCBs can be converted into equity shares of entity which is issuing those bonds, whereas FCEB cannot be converted into equity shares of entity which is issuing those bonds, but can be exchanged with the equity shares of another entity apart from the entity which is issuing those bonds. And finance lease, basically you know what finance lease means. There will be 5 types of conditions under, we have learned it under Ind AS. If those conditions are satisfied, then that will be finance lease. Otherwise, operating lease. Even finance lease can be, even ECB can be taken in the form of finance lease. These are the types of ECBs. Now, let us move into eligible borrowers. That means, who are the borrowers who can raise ECBs? That means, eligible resident entities which can raise ECBs. Let us discuss them. See, we have discussed that there are 2 types of ECBs under the currency in which they are raised. That is foreign currency denominated ECB and Indian rupee denominated ECBs. These eligible borrowers are different for these 2 types of denominated ECBs. There will be different eligible borrowers for foreign currency denominated ECB, and there will be different types of eligible borrowers for Indian rupee denominated ECBs. Let us see them. Under foreign currency denominated ECBs, the first eligible entity is all entities eligible to receive foreign direct investment. All those entities will be eligible to raise ECB also. Let us see who are those entities which are eligible for FDIs in the next slide. Moving to second eligible entity, that is port trusts. Let's say, for example, we are having a Mumbai port. For Mumbai port, there is a trust established for the purpose of seeing the activities, for the purpose of taking care of activities that are happening in the port. The such type of trust will be known as port trust. This port trust can raise ECBs in foreign currency denomination. And the third eligible entity will be units in special economic zone. Even these units can raise foreign currency denominated ECBs. And the fourth entity will be SIDBI, that is Small Industrial Development Bank of India. Even this bank can raise ECBs denominated in foreign currency. And the fifth entity will be Exim Bank, that is Export Import Bank of India. Even it can raise ECBs in foreign currency denomination. Coming to Indian rupee denominated ECBs. All the entities which are eligible to raise foreign currency denominated ECBs are also eligible to raise Indian rupee denominated ECBs. Apart from those entities, registered entities engaged in microfinance activities are also eligible to raise ECBs. See, I have forgot to tell you a basic concept, that is ECB means loan which is raised from outside India. The basic question that might arise is why these people are going for ECBs instead of borrowing from in India itself. This is the basic question that any that will be raised for any people. See, if you want to borrow in India, the interest rates might be higher. Let's say in India we can get a business loan at around 12%, but whereas if you borrow from outside of India, let's say in US, the rate of interest will be very low. You can get a loan at around 4% of interest. This is the main reason why most of people will go for ECBs. And another reason why people might go for ECB is, let's say there is an Indian company, and this Indian company is having a subsidiary in US. Now this Indian company wants to get a loan from the take a loan from its US subsidiary, which is located in US. Now since it wants to get loan from its US subsidiary, it will go for ECB. Even this loan from foreign subsidiary will also be covered under ECB. Okay, these are the main reasons why entities will go for ECB. Now coming to our point, registered entities engaged in microfinance activities. See, these entities which are engaged in microfinance activities will raise large amount of ECBs at lower interest rate, and they will give loans in small amounts to small individual businesses in India at somewhat higher rates. This will be their business model. Even these entities can raise Indian rupee denominated ECBs. Here we are saying that registered entities with whom they have to register. They have to be registered under Societies Act, Registration of Societies Act. Registered entities engaged in microfinance activities can raise ECBs in Indian rupee denominated ECBs. Okay. Now let us see what are the entities which are eligible to receive foreign direct investment. Basically, under foreign direct investment, there is a negative list. That means entities that have been specified in the negative list cannot receive foreign direct investment. Apart from those entities, all other entities can receive foreign direct investment. Let us see what is the negative list under foreign direct investment. First one, first entity. I will be just reading this, all these entities, you will be able to understand them. First entity, business of chit fund, nidhi company, agricultural or plantation activities. That means any entity which is engaged in agricultural or plantation activities, such type of entity cannot accept foreign direct investment. Fourth entity, entity engaged in real estate business or construction of farm houses or trading in transferable development rights. We have discussed what is meant by this transferable development right while discussing our capital account transaction. I think while discussing capital account transaction, we have discussed what is meant by this transferable development right. Coming to sixth entity, lottery business including government private lottery, online lotteries, gambling and betting including casinos, chit funds, nidhi company, trading in transferable, okay, same point repeated, real estate business, manufacturing of cigars, cheroots, cigarillos and cigarettes of tobacco or of tobacco substitutes, activity sectors not open to private sector investment, example atomic energy, railway operations. These are the entities which cannot accept foreign direct investment. apart from these entities, all other entities can accept foreign direct investment. Hope this is clear. Now, moving to recognized lenders. We have understood who are eligible resident entities for raising external commercial borrowings. Okay. From whom these eligible entities can raise the ECBs? Those are known as recognized lenders. These eligible borrowers can raise ECBs only from these recognized lenders. Let us see who are those recognized lenders. First one, lender should be resident of FATF or IOSCO compliant country. See, first of all, what is this FATF? FATF means Financial Action Task Force. Basically, this is a global organization that will issue some guidelines for the purpose of money laundering or for some activities relating to FEMA. These guidelines have to be followed by all other countries, and all other countries have to prepare their own laws based on these guidelines or criteria, you can say, issued by this FATF. That is the main purpose of FATF. Coming to IOSCO, it is International Organization for Securities Commission, Securities Commissions. Basically, in India, we are having SEBI for the purpose of controlling transactions related to stock markets. In the same way, in other countries, we will be having their respective authorities for controlling their security market transaction. Now, all these authorities of different countries will be governed by IOSCO. This is the International Organization for Securities Commissions. These organization will issue, same like FATF, some guidelines, and these guidelines have to be followed by remaining all the authorities of different countries. This is the main concept of FATF and IOSCO. Now let us read it. Lender should be resident of FATF or IOSCO compliant country. That means the country from which you are raising ECB should comply with the guidelines issued by FATF or IOSCO. Only then you can raise ECB from the resident of that country. This is the first recognized lender. Coming to second lender who is recognized for the purpose of raising ECBs. Multilateral and regional financial institutions where India is a member country will also be considered as recognized lenders. See, multilateral means those kind of institution that has been developed by more than one country, and regional means we have been developed only by one country. Example of multilateral financial institution is International Monetary Fund. Almost all the company, all the countries are part of this International Monetary Fund. The purpose of IMF is to give monetary facility or monetary support to the developing countries for the purpose of their development. This is the purpose of IMF. It is example of multilateral financial institution. You can raise ECB from these types of organizations. And second, regional financial institution. Example of a regional financial institution is, you can say, SIDBI, Small Industrial Development Bank of India. This has been developed by our India. Even you can raise ECB from those types of regional financials, financial institutions which have been developed by other countries. In India, we have SIDBI. In the same way, in other countries, they will be having some other financial institutions. You can raise ECBs from those financial institutions. Even they are considered as recognized lenders for the purpose of raising ECBs. Coming to the third lender who is eligible, that is, who is recognized. Individuals as lenders can only be permitted if they are foreign equity holders or for subscription to bonds, debentures listed abroad. See, let us understand this third point with the help of an example. Let's say in India we are having Reliance Industries. Now this Reliance Industries wants to raise ECB from Warren Buffett. You know who Warren Buffett is? He is a stock market investor. He is an individual. Now Reliance Industries wants to raise ECB from any individual. Now it can raise ECB from the individual only if this Warren Buffett is equity holder of this Reliance Industries. If he has investment in the equity shares of Reliance Industries, only then Reliance Industries can raise ECB from Warren Buffett. This is applicable only if you want to raise ECB from an individual. Let us read this sentence once again, you will be able to understand. Individuals, that is Warren Buffett, as lenders can only be permitted if they are foreign equity holders. That means they are having equity investment in the company which wants to raise ECB, or for subscription to bonds, debentures listed abroad, etc. Or he must have been invested in equity share of Reliance Industries, or if he has not invested, at least he should have subscribed to the bonds or debentures that have been issued by this Reliance Industries abroad. See, this Reliance Industries might have issued some listed debentures abroad. At least Warren Buffett should have subscribed those debentures. Only in that case he can lend amount to this Reliance Industries in the form of external commercial borrowings. Hope this concept is clear to you. Coming to the fourth recognized lender, foreign branches, subsidiaries of Indian banks are permitted as recognized lenders only for foreign currency ECBs, except FCCBs and FCEBs. See, let us say in India we are having HDFC Bank. Now this HDFC Bank has its branch in US. Now an eligible borrower in India wants, tell you the example once again. In India we are having HDFC Bank. This HDFC Bank has its branch in US. Now eligible resident in India wants to raise ECB from the foreign branch of this HDFC Bank. Whether he can raise or not, the answer is yes, he can raise. In which currency he has to raise? He has to raise only in foreign currency. He cannot raise in Indian rupee denominated ECB. If he wants to raise Indian rupees, he can directly get this amount from the HDFC Bank in India. Why should he go to foreign branch of HDFC for raising Indian rupees? So if an eligible entity in India wants to raise ECBs from foreign branch of an Indian financial institution, then he can raise only foreign currency denominated ECBs. He cannot raise Indian rupee denominated ECBs. That is a point. Also, this eligible entity cannot raise FCCBs and FCEBs from foreign branch of Indian bank. Okay, hope you understood up till here. Moving forward, foreign branches, subsidiaries of Indian banks subject to applicable prudential norms can participate as arrangers, underwriters, market makers, traders for rupee denominated bonds issued overseas. See, Reliance Industries in India wants to issue its bonds abroad. Now, for the purpose of issuing these bonds abroad, Reliance Industry will be requiring an underwriter or some facilitator to help Reliance Industries to issue these bonds. Now, this foreign branch of our HDFC can help Reliance Industries for the purpose of issuing such INR denominated bonds. That has been said in this point. However, underwriting by foreign branches subsidiaries of Indian banks for issuances by Indian banks will not be allowed. See, now let's say we are having ICICI bank in India. Now this ICICI bank wants to issue in INR denominated bonds abroad. Now for the purpose of issuing such bonds abroad, it wants to take help of foreign branch of HDFC. That will not be allowed. Okay, hope you understood this. These are the recognized lenders from whom you can raise ECBs. Now moving to minimum average maturity period. That means what is the minimum period for which ECB has to be raised. That means you can say lock-in period for which ECB has to be raised. Generally, the minimum average maturity period will be 3 years. That means an ECB has to be raised minimum for 3 years. You should not repay the ECB that has been raised within 3 years. That is a general period that is applicable. However, for specific cases, other periods have been specified. Let us see them. See, these are the specific cases for which different maturity periods have been prescribed. For general cases, the maturity period will be 3 years. For these specific cases, we are having different maturity period. First of all, let us understand what are the cases. Purpose, that is, what is the purpose for which you are raising the ECB? If it is for the, there are four types of purposes. First one will be for working capital purpose you are raising ECB, or second one will be for general corporate purposes, third one will be for repayment of domestic rupee loans, and fourth one will be on lending by NBFC. Okay, now borrowed from whom you are borrowing this ECB, and minimum average maturity period. What will be the minimum average maturity period? Let us see it. See, if you are borrowing ECB for working capital purpose and that borrowing is from FEH, that is foreign equity holder, then first one will be from foreign equity holder or other than foreign equity holder. If you are raising from foreign equity holder, then the minimum average maturity period will be 5 years. Other than foreign equity holder, 10 years. Same will be the case in the next case. If you are rising for general corporate purpose and you are rising from foreign equity holder, other than foreign equity holder, if foreign equity holder, minimum maturity period 5 years, others 10 years. Okay. These are the first two cases. Moving to third case, that is repayment of domestic rupee loans. What does this mean? Let us understand this with an example. Let's say again Reliance Industries. This Reliance Industries has raised loan from SBI Bank in India. Let's say the rate of interest is 12%. Now it has been paying the EMIs and some time has passed. Now this Reliance Industries has came to know that if it raises ECB from, let's say, US, then it can raise the loan for just 4%. Here in India it is paying 12% to SBI. If it rises from US, it will be, the cost will be just 4%. Now what this in Reliance Industries does is it will raise ECB for 4% from US, and with these proceeds it will repay the domestic rupee loan that it has bought taken from SBI. This is the purpose, that is repayment of domestic rupee loans. Let us see the maturity period under this. If you are taking ECBs from foreign equity holders, others, same as we have seen in previous cases. If you take the ECB from foreign equity holders, there will be one type of maturity period. From others, there will be other type of maturity period. But in this third purpose, foreign equity holder, that will be 5%, 5 years, that will be same. Here we get a new column, new row, that is purpose of secondary loan. What is the secondary loan in this case? The primary loan is ECB that you are raising, and the secondary loan is repayment of domestic loan, the loan that is already in existence. This Reliance Industries has taken a loan from SBI. This is the secondary loan, and the primary loan is that it want to take in the form of ECB. Purpose of secondary loan. What is the purpose of this secondary loan? Why did Reliance Industries has taken the loan from SBI? It can be for two purposes. One is for incurring capital expenditure, and the other is other than capital expenditure. If the secondary loan, the purpose of secondary loan is capital expenditure, if the Reliance Industries wants to raise ECB for the purpose of repayment of its secondary loan which has been raised for capital expenditure, then the minimum average maturity period will be 7 years. Hope you understood this. If the purpose of secondary loan was other than capital expenditure, then the minimum average maturity period will be 10 years. Hope you understood this third case. Moving to fourth case, that is on lending by NBFC. What is this on lending by NBFC means? See, there is a particular NBFC in India. We can raise loans from foreign countries at a cheaper rate. Now, what this NBFC does is, it will raise bulk amount through ECBs at cheaper interest rate. Now, this NBFC will lend this amount to small business people in India at somewhat higher interest rate. This is known as on lending by NBFC. That means it has taken a loan in the form of ECB, and it is lending this amount to other people. This is known as on lending. In this case, what is the secondary loan? The secondary loan is the loan that NBFC will be granting to various small business people, and the primary loan will be ECB that has been raised by NBFC. Let's see the case. On lending by NBFC, borrowed from whom it is borrowing, that is from whom it is raising the ECB. Anybody. In previous cases, we have the bifurcation of foreign equity holder or other than foreign equity holder. There is no such bifurcation in case of ECB is raised by NBFC, borrowed from anybody. Purpose of secondary loan. Here the secondary loan means the loan that NBFC will be granting to small business people, that is on lending by NBFC, that will be the secondary loan. What is the purpose of secondary loan? There will be four purposes. First one, for working capital purposes. See, if NBFC has taken ECB and this amount is being used by NBFC for giving working capital loans in India, then the minimum average maturity period will be 10 years. That is the first purpose. Moving to second one, for corporate expenditure. If NBFC taking ECB and using these proceeds for giving loans for the purpose of corporate expenditure, then the minimum average maturity will be again 10 years. Third case, if NBFC is granting loan for capital expenditure, then the minimum average maturity period will be 7 years. And the next case, other than capital expenditure, minimum average maturity period will be 10 years. Hope you understood this entire chart. Apart from these cases, there is one other case, that is ECB raised by manufacturing companies up to $50 million or its equivalent per financial year, then the minimum average maturity period will be 1 year. This is the entire concept of minimum average maturity period. Hope you understood this. Moving to our next concept. See, all-in cost. Maximum all-in cost. First of all, let us understand what is this all-in cost. See, when you take a loan, what types of expenditure you will incur? The first major expenditure will be interest that you have to pay while repaying the loan. That is the first cost. And the second cost will be, while taking the loan, there will be some processing charges. That will be the second cost. And the third charge will be, if you want to repay the loan before the maturity of the loan, then bank will charge some prepayment penalty charges. Third expense will be prepayment penalty charges. Okay. And in this case, you are raising ECB. That means you are raising amount from outside India in, let's say, dollars. While repaying the loan, the exchange, that is the dollar rate, might have increased. Then you have to incur additional expenditure in the form of exchange fluctuation. This will be another cost if you have raised loan in the foreign currency. These are the major costs that will be incurred if you raise a loan. All these costs together will be called as all-in cost. Now, what is the maximum all-in cost that you can incur if you raise ECB? That is, the maximum all-in cost will be benchmark rate plus 450 basis points. The benchmark rate will be the rate that is existing on the date on which you are raising ECB, plus the spread will be 4.5%. An extra 4.5% can be incurred as all-in cost by you. That is the maximum all-in cost. Moving to exchange rate to convert foreign currency ECB to Indian rupee denominated ECB. Let's say, first of all, you have raised ECB in foreign currency denomination, and after some period, you want to convert this foreign currency denominated ECB into Indian rupee denominated ECB. Whether you can do such conversion or not, the answer is yes, you can convert. At what rate you can convert? The rate prevailing on the date of such a conversion agreement, the rate that has been existing on the date on which you have entered into agreement for such conversion, has to be applied for the purpose of such conversion. I'll repeat it once again. See, there will be two cases. First one will be, you want to convert foreign currency denominated ECB into Indian rupee denominated ECB. Whether you can convert or not, the answer is yes, you can convert at the rate that is existing on the date of agreement. That is the first case. You keep it aside. That has been said in this point. And there will be another case. In this case, you want to convert Indian rupee denominated ECB to foreign currency denominated ECB. Whether you can convert or not, the answer is no. The government, the RBI, will not permit for converting Indian rupee denominated ECB to foreign currency denominated ECB, because this will result into loss to India in the form of foreign currency. That is the reason why a conversion from Indian rupee to foreign currency denominated ECB will not be allowed. Okay, hope this is clear to you. Hedging provisions. See, we have discussed that if we raise loan in the form of ECB from outside India, then the cost of loan will be impacted by the increase or decrease of our foreign currency. That is, you can call them as exchange fluctuations. To avoid these exchange fluctuations, you have to hedge the loan that you have taken. What are the hedging provisions? See, infrastructure companies have to mandatorily hedge 70% of their ECB exposure in case average maturity period, here AM means average maturity period, is less than 5 years. See, if an infrastructure company raises ECB and the average maturity period for such ECB is less than 5 years, then such company must mandatorily hedge 70% of loan raised. That is the condition that has been prescribed under ECB regulations. Also, coming to second point, authorized dealer category 1 bank has to verify and report to RBI in form ECB 2. See, this authorized dealer category 1 bank has to verify whether the infrastructure company has actually hedged 70% of its exposure or not. After verifying it, it has to submit its report to RBI in the form of form ECB 2. These are the hedging provisions. So this point we have already discussed. Change of external commercial borrowing currency from foreign currency to Indian rupee is freely permissible, but from Indian rupee to foreign currency is not permitted. Okay. Moving to parking of ECB proceeds. Let's say you have raised some, let's say 1 crore dollars for some working capital purpose or something like that. And once you raised, you will not immediately use it. There will be some time to use it. You will use this amount in a progressive manner. Till the time you use the entire amount, you have to park these proceeds in certain investments or in certain types of accounts that have been specified under the ECB guidelines. Let us see what are the options available to you for the purpose of parking this ECB proceeds. There will be two categories. First one, proceeds meant for foreign currency expenditure. You want to incur foreign currency expenditure from the proceeds raised through ECB. That will be the first category. And the second category will be proceeds meant for Indian rupee currency expenditure. Basically two categories. From ECB that you have raised, you want to incur expenditure in foreign currency only, or you want to incur expenditure in Indian currency. Under these two categories, where can you park your ECB proceeds? Under first category, can be parked abroad. Since you want to incur foreign expenditure from these ECB proceeds, you can keep this amount abroad itself. Abroad where? Okay. You can keep these proceeds abroad. If you want to incur expenditure in India, then you should be repatriated immediately to India and can only be parked in India. Such amount which you want to spend in India cannot be kept abroad. You have to immediately get them to India and you have to park them in India. What are the accounts in which you can park them? Let's see. For foreign currency expenditure, you can deposit this amount in deposits of banks rated not less than AA-. You can deposit in the banks with rating of not less than AA-. That is the first option available with you for parking the proceeds. Or treasury bills and other monetary instruments of 1 year maturity having rate not less than AA-, same rating. And the third option will be deposits with foreign branches of Indian banks. We have seen you can deposit these amounts with the foreign branches of Indian banks, that is foreign branch of HDFC bank or ICICI bank or SBI bank. In such types of foreign branches, you can invest the proceeds of ECB. And in case of Indian rupee expenditure, if you want to use that ECB for incurring expenditure in India in terms of rupees, where you can park the amount? First option will be term deposits of authorized dealer category 1 banks in India for maximum of 12 months. That is the only option available for parking your proceeds. That is with the term deposits of authorized dealer category 1 bank in India, and the maximum period up to which you can deposit these proceeds is 12 months. Moving to next concept. Till here we have completed ECB. Under ECB, there are certain special cases which have been specified. Let us discuss these special cases. first first special case. ECB facility for oil manufacturing marketing companies. If a oil marketing company, let's say BPCL, Bharat Petroleum Corporation of India, wants to raise ECB, then there are certain special procedure prescribed. Let us see what is that. Can raise ECB for working capital purposes with minimum average maturity period of 3 years. These oil marketing companies can raise ECB for minimum maturity period of 3 years from all recognized lenders under the automatic route. They can raise under automatic route. And overall ceiling for such ECB shall be $10 billion or equivalent. These oil marketing companies cannot raise more than $10 billion. That is the limit that has been prescribed for oil marketing companies, and no hedging requirement exists. That is the first special case under ECB. Another thing, here I am not dealing with procedural part. There is some procedural part in ECB that I haven't dealt. You can just read it. That is very easy, and you can understand the procedure once you read it. If you have any doubts, you can ask me and I will clarify them. Okay, that I haven't dealt in this video. You please read it. And coming to the second special case under ECB, ECB facility for startups. For startups, some criteria has been specified. Let us see. Eligibility: entity recognized as startup by central government as on date of raising ECB. Okay, as on the date on which this company wants to raise ECB, as on that date, if it has been recognized as a startup by central government, then it will be eligible to raise ECB under this scheme. What is the maturity? Minimum average maturity period will be 3 years. Okay. Recognized lender. Who will be the recognized lender? Lender or investor shall be resident of FATF compliant country. Okay, we have already seen what this point means. And the currency: the borrowing should be denominated in any freely convertible currency or Indian rupees or a combination thereof. Okay, there is no any restriction. You can raise in whatever currency you can want, but that must be freely convertible currency. And the limit: borrowing per startup will be limited to $3 million or equivalent per year. See, a startup can raise only up to $3 million per year, and an oil marketing company can raise up to $10 billion per year. This is the second special case under ECB. Third special case: borrowing by entities under investigation. Eligibility: all entities against which investigation, adjudication, appeal for violation of any of the provisions of FEMA pending may raise ECB as per the applicable norms if they are otherwise eligible to raise ECBs. See, let's say there is some adjudication or some proceeding pending against an entity under FEMA. Now this entity wants to raise ECB. Whether it can raise ECB or not, the answer is yes, it can raise ECB. The fact that a proceeding is pending against the entity will not avoid this entity from raising the ECB, provided that it must have been eligible to raise the ECB. Okay, in that case it can raise the ECB even though a proceeding is pending against the entity under FEMA. And the borrowing entity shall inform about pendency of such investigation, adjudication, appeal to authorized dealer category 1 bank or RBI as the case may be prescribed. See, however, a particular condition has been prescribed on these entities which are undergoing an investigation. If these types of entities wants to raise ECB, then they have to disclose to the authorized dealer category 1 bank that this type of adjudication or proceeding is pending against me and I want to raise ECB. This type of disclosure has to be made by this entity. Okay, this is the third special case under ECB. Moving to next special case, ECB by entities under restructuring or IBC. That means entities which are undergoing insolvency process. How should these entities obtain ECB? An entity which is under a restructuring scheme or corporate insolvency resolution process can raise ECB only if specifically permitted under the resolution plan. See, if an entity which is undergoing insolvency resolution plan resolution process wants to raise an ECB, then it has to be permitted under the resolution plan. If it hasn't been permitted under the resolution plan, then such entity cannot raise ECB. That is the first condition for such type of for such type of companies to raise ECBs. Okay, moving to the second point, eligible corporate borrowers who have availed rupee loans domestically for capital expenditure in manufacturing and infrastructure infrastructure sector and which have been classified as SMA2 or NPA can avail ECB for repayment of these loans under any one-time settlement with lenders. See, an entity has raised Indian rupee loans for some capital expenditure and such type of loan has been categorized as NPA by the Indian bank. Now if this type of entity can raise ECB from foreign country and can repay the loan that has been classified as NPA, provided that the resolution plan permits it. Okay, that is the second point. Coming to third point, eligible borrowers under ECB framework who are participating in CIRP under IBC 2016 as a resolution applicants can raise ECB from all recognized lenders except foreign branches subsidiaries of Indian banks for repayment of rupee term loans. Such ECB will be considered under approval route. See, this entities which are undergoing corporate insolvency resolution plan wants to raise ECB from foreign branch of an Indian bank for repayment of the loan that has been taken from the Indian bank. If this is the situation, then it cannot automatically raise the ECB. For this purpose, it has to compulsorily move through the approval route only. Only through the approval route it can raise ECB from foreign branch of an Indian bank to repay the Indian rupee denominated loan that has been taken from the Indian bank. Hope this concept is clear to you. And that's it. We have completed our ECB. And again, I am saying I haven't covered some procedural aspect under ECB. You please go through that procedural aspect. Some loan registration number, these types of topics have been covered under that procedural procedural aspect. You can read them and you can understand it. Still we are having overseas direct investment. What I suggest you is the ODI is a small concept, and you can understand it if you read it once. What I suggest you is you please read it once, and if you have any doubts regarding ODI, you please message me. I will clarify your doubts. From by this video, our FEMA topic has been completed, and that's it for today, guys. Bye bye.